So let's turn once again. This time let's turn to the book of Mark. Mark chapter 8. We'll pick it up in verse 27. Mark chapter 8, verse 27. This morning we're going to continue the series that we began several weeks ago. If you haven't been with us, you probably should go online and you go to the website. You can actually listen to the message series we've been in. We've been talking together about what it means to be a follower of Jesus Christ. And we've learned some very important truths. We have learned that apart from Christ, we are dead in our sins and our trespasses. But when we put our faith and our trust in Jesus, the Bible says that we come alive, that life comes into us. That's where we get this whole idea about being born again. All of a sudden, we live again. We have a new life that is a part of our existence. And yet, part of the failings, I think, of the church is that we have assumed that spiritual growth is going to be an automatic process. We learned last week that the first stage of spiritual growth when we become followers of Christ is that we're nothing more than babies. I had the privilege of going up a couple of times and seeing Susan when she was at the hospital and seeing the baby. And I love going in and seeing the newborn babies. And I asked Jacob when he came in this morning, I said, did she sleep good? Did she sleep all night last night? And he went, no. And I didn't have the heart to tell him, just wait. Just wait. Children are something special. You see, there's a procession. We go from being a newborn baby in Christ to being a child in Christ, and then to being a young adult, and then being a parent, being able to bring others into the kingdom. But I got to tell you, that doesn't happen automatically. It takes a lot of effort on our part. It takes the same thing to move from stage to stage. It takes an intimate relationship with Jesus Christ. It takes a full commitment to His Word. It takes a lot of different kinds of stuff. But the truth is, we're going to be talking today about the child stage. Because once we've gone from being that baby, just desiring the milk, if you come and sit under the preaching and teaching of God's Word, if you get on your knees and you pray and you develop that intimate relationship, you will begin to grow. God will begin to transform and change your life. And you'll go from being a baby to being a child. But I got to tell you, being a child is not always the best thing in the world to be. It's okay to be a child. It's not okay to stay a child. We have to continue to grow in that process. Let me tell you something. I have some experience with children. I have two of my own. Some of you know what it's like to have a child. You know what children will do. Sometimes children can, well, let's be honest, they can learn the language of their older peers. They can speak the words that they hear their older siblings talking about. We understand that in the physical realm, don't we? Have you ever had your kids where they play that repeat after me game where they, you know, the older one goes, Mom, make her quit. She keeps saying everything I'm saying. And in the background you hear, saying everything I'm saying. You know, you hear that thing going back and forth. Sometimes children get into that habit. Let me tell you something. In the spiritual realm, same thing happens. A follower of Jesus Christ, they go from being a baby to being a child, and they see somebody that's more mature spiritually, and they hear the language that they're using, they hear the words that they're speaking, and they pick up the language. And so that sometimes they can sit there and be a child and still be, they can speak the right words and still be nothing more than a child. Sometimes they will imitate the behavior of their older siblings. We know that in the physical realm. We understand that in the physical realm. In the spiritual realm, same thing happens. If you go to church often enough, all of a sudden, you see somebody else that's a little bit further along spiritually than you are. You want to imitate them, but you're still a child. You're not sure why you're doing it. You're just imitating their behavior. You see, the truth is that children, I hate to say this about kids, they're self-centered. I just described half of us, didn't I? And it's probably true because we may be a little bit childish. Children tend to want their own way. Children tend to focus on their own life. Children don't really think about other people. They tend to be prideful. They tend to be very easily offended. Some of you are taking offense already. See, when we're children, when that's our level of spiritual development, when we're just a child, there comes a time where we need to lay aside childish things. We need to get rid of the toy box, so to speak. Plump Anna McGee went into the barbershop one Monday morning. He said, "You will not believe how immature my wife Rose was yesterday." Rasta said, "What did she do?" He said, I was in the bathroom getting ready to go to church. I was in the bathtub. She came pounding on the door. She said, pump handle, get out of that bathtub. We're going to be late for church. I said, I'll be out in a minute. He said, it wasn't 5 minutes later. She come busting open the door. She took away all of my toy boats. Can you believe that? Think about it. She was immature, remember? Let me tell you something about boats. When you're little, it may be a toy boat. But as a child that's older, the only difference is the price of the boat. The only difference is the price that we pay. You see, I am convinced that if we're going to make an impact on our world, if we're going to change the world that surrounds us, then you and I have to grow up. And it's time to put away some childish things. Look at your neighbor and say, it's time to put away your toys. Tell them right now. Mark chapter 8. Mark chapter 8. We're going to pick it up in verse 27. Fortunately, what we're going to be talking about is seen in the life of one individual, specifically in Scripture. This man is a follower of Jesus. This man is a man of great insight and great wisdom. But he's also a child. He has some childish ways, maybe like you and maybe like me. The challenge today is for us to grow beyond where we are to where we need to be. We need to be growing in our faith. Mark chapter 8, verse 27. Are you there? Hold your Bibles up. Listen as I read from God's Word. Listen to what it says. Now Jesus and his disciples went out to the towns of Caesarea Philippi. And on the road he asked his disciples, saying, who do men say that I am? And so they answered, John the Baptist. But some say Elijah, and others one of the prophets. And he said to them, but who do you say that I am? Peter answered and said to him, you are the Christ. Some of the parallel passages that deal with this same issue. Jesus turns to Peter and says, flesh and blood didn't reveal this to you. This was a revelation from God. This is deep spiritual insight. Deep spiritual insight. You're looking at Peter and you're going, wow, to be that deep, to be that close to God. Here is a man that for 3 years had been following Jesus around. Here is a man that wasn't just one of the 12. He was one of the 12, and not just one of the 12. He was one of that inner circle. And yet in just a few minutes, Jesus is going to turn to him and say, get behind me, Satan. You see, we can go from spiritual insight to spiritual immaturity just like that. Let me say it again, because it's important that we understand what we're dealing with here. We can go from having spiritual insight to being spiritually immature very quickly. Very quickly. Let's keep reading. Then Jesus strictly warned them that they should tell no one about him. And he began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, the scribes, and be killed, and after 3 days rise again. He spoke these words openly. This is not a parable. This is nothing secretive. He spoke those words clearly. Everybody should have got this. Notice what happens. Then Peter took Jesus aside and began to rebuke him. But when he turned around and looked at his disciples, he rebuked Peter, saying, get behind me, Satan, for you are not mindful of the things of God, but the things of men. Didn't take very long, did it? He went from this deep spiritual insight, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God, to being an immature child. He went from acting as though he knew it all. Listen, just because you know some things doesn't mean you know everything. Just because I know some things doesn't mean I know everything. The call to discipleship is a call to grow. It's a call to go from being dead to alive. It's a call from being born again as a baby to being a child. It's a call to go from being a child to being an adult. It's a call to put the toys away, to lay aside the childish things. Let's keep reading. Verse 34. And when he had called the people to himself with his disciples, he also said to them, whoever desires to come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. There's the call to follow Christ. For whoever will desire to save his life will lose it. Whoever loses his life for my sake and for the gospel's will save it. What will it profit a man if he gains the whole world and loses his own soul? What will a man give in exchange for his soul? Listen to this. For whoever is ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of him the Son of Man will be ashamed when he comes in glory, in the glory of his Father with the holy angels. Chapter 9, just verse 1. Listen to what it says. And he said to them, assuredly I say to you that there are some standing here who will not taste death until they see the kingdom of God present with power. Now, I don't know about you, but my desire is to grow to that place where I see the kingdom of God present in my life, present in my church, not just present, but with power. But that'll never happen until I lay aside my childish things. It's time to put up our toys. It's time to put away our toys. Look at your neighbor one more time and tell him, it's really time to put away our toys. Tell him right now. Now the reality is that Peter looked like he was a follower of Christ, but sometimes he looked like a child. And the truth is that I'm a follower of Christ. Sometimes I look like a child. Sometimes I act very childlike. Sometimes I act very childish. Sometimes I get my feelings hurt over nothing. Sometimes I get offended very easily. Sometimes I want my way. Don't you? And yet the reality is that it's time for me to put away my childish things. It's time for me to go to a deeper level in my relationship with God. Think with me for just a minute about the truth about being a spiritual child. Things that we see in this passage of Scripture. Number one, I can have spiritual insight and still be a spiritual child. I can have insight. I can understand some things that the Bible teaches, but I may not know how to apply it completely to my life. I may not know the impact that it wants to have on me. I can have spiritual insight and still be a spiritual child. Notice what it says. But Jesus said to them, who do you say that I am? And Peter said to him, you are the Christ. That is great insight. Knowing and recognizing that Jesus is the Savior, that is great insight. But that's not enough. Just recognizing that He is the Savior is the beginning place of our following Him, not the ending place. It's just the beginning of discipleship. Simon Peter made this great confession, had this great impact. It's the foundation of the church itself. Jesus said, you know, this confession, on this rock I will build my church. That's the foundation stone of everything we believe, that Jesus is the Christ. But 10, 15 minutes later, that very same man that had this great deep spiritual insight, Jesus rebuked him and said, you're acting like the devil now. You're acting in rebellion now. You see, the truth is, just because we show up on Sunday morning and we hear preaching and teaching and we walk out going, oh, that was a great sermon, I got it, doesn't mean that we've grown beyond just being a child. Sometimes it means that we're in that process of growth, but it may not mean that we're where we need to be. Sometimes children can have great insight. Have your children ever humbled you by what they've said? A little girl climbed up into her mother's lap one day and was noticing the streaks of gray. I said, Mom, why do you have gray hair? And the mother, seeing this as a great teachable moment, she thought for a minute and she said, well, you know, honey, every one of these gray hairs in Mama's head, it's one of those times you didn't obey me. Yeah. She thought she was pretty clever until her little girl thought for a minute and said, oh, so you're why Grandma has all that gray hair. Now, let me tell you something. That little girl had some insight, but she was just a child. So you see, what I'm trying to get you to understand is just because you go to church, and just because every once in a while you walk out and you've got that little nugget, you just go, I got it, doesn't mean that we know it all. Doesn't mean that we've learned it all. Right, Mary? Mary's out there nodding her head. I wasn't picking on her because she was being, I was picking on her because she was agreeing. See, the reality is that we can know some things and still not know everything because we're still just children. We're still just children. Second thing we want to think about. The truth about being a spiritual child. Not only can I have spiritual insight and be a spiritual child, I can hear the message clearly and still think I know a better way. Children tend to do that. Have you ever told your child to do something in a clear and resonant tone only for them to go out and do just the opposite? Yeah, that's exactly what happens. Listen to what happens here. And Jesus began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things, be rejected by the elders, the chief priests and the scribes, and be killed, and after 3 days rise again. Jesus spoke this word openly. That's what it says. And notice the next line. Then Peter took Jesus aside and began to rebuke him. You know what that means? That means that Jesus stood up and said, Peter, all you guys need to understand, I'm about to go to Jerusalem. I'm going to be handed over to the leadership. They're going to crucify me. I'm going to be buried and dead. And Simon Peter went, oh no, that doesn't fit my plans. That's not the way I have it figured out. Let's do it a different way. You've got to do it my way, Jesus. We got to do it some other way. The reality is I can hear the message clearly and still think I know a better way. A child always wants things their way. Listen, I've raised two, and to this day, mine are grown, and they still want things their way. Anybody know what I'm talking about? But to be quite honest with you, my wife will tell you that I still want my way too. And my guess is, so do you. My guess is that we're all a little bit like this. We hear the message clearly. The message was Jesus was going to die. The message was that he was going to rise again. This word was clearly spoken. But Peter thought he had a better way. Why is it that we read this book and we see it plainly here? We understand what it says, but we still think we have a better idea. Ladies come to me, and the Bible says very clearly, don't be unequally yoked with an unbeliever. That means Christians shouldn't marry non-Christians. Oh, but preacher, that cuts out half of my prospects. And this is what you hear a lot. But you know, I really believe God wants me to get him saved. And I say, yes, before you marry him, not after. But I know what it says, but I've got a better idea. I'll marry him and then change him. You see, the reality is we can be a child, and one of the signs of us being a child is that we hear the message clearly and still think we have a better way. That's the way kids are. Listen, you want to get your kid to do something that they don't want to do, you find out what it is that they don't want to do and tell them to do that. And they'll generally do what you don't want them to do. Let's keep going. Think about it. The truth about being a spiritual child. I can have spiritual insight and still be a spiritual child. I can hear the message clearly and think I know a better way. Third thing, I can be among his followers and still have my focus on the wrong thing. This is a plague in the church today. We would all consider ourselves followers of Christ, but many of us still have our focus on the wrong things. Listen to what Jesus said. Jesus turned around and looked at his disciples. He looked at his disciples. He rebuked Peter, saying, "Get behind me, Satan, for you're not mindful of the things of God, but the things of men." You see, I can be among the followers of Christ and still have my focus on the things of men. I can be looking at the wrong kinds of things. I can be doing what people tend to do in our society. I can behave in a childlike manner. I can stop those bad sins, but I'm going to hang on to my pet sins. You see, the reality is we focus on power and popularity and prosperity and being politically correct. We focus on those kind of things. Preachers do it all the time. They stand in the pulpit and they're going to preach so that everybody will like them. The truth is that doesn't help us grow. Sometimes we need to hear what we need to hear and not what we want to hear. Sometimes we need to be those people that focus on not the things of men, but on the things of God.
was thinking about Jacob, and I heard a story once, Jacob, about a father who was pushing a stroller through the park with his newborn baby in it. The baby was just screaming at the top of his lungs. The father would take a couple of steps and push the baby in very quiet, measured tones, would say, "It'll be okay, Donald." A few minutes later, he said, "We'll be home in a little while, Donald. Just relax, Donald." And this little old lady was walking beside him and had overheard all this. And she said, "Sir, I just have to compliment you. You're doing everything in your power to comfort your little baby." And she said, I'm just so impressed. You just so such measured tones, and you're just so quiet in the way you deal with it." And she leaned over, looked in that stroller, and she said, "Now, Donald, what's the problem?" And the guy said, "His name is Henry. I'm Donald." You see how easy it is to get focused on the wrong things? How many times are you and I guilty of focusing on the wrong things? We focus on the things of men, the things of the world around us. We get so caught up in the wrong kinds of things. Hey, think about it. Think about it. We will teach our sons to go and hunt for deer, and we won't teach them to seek God like a deer that pants after water. Why is it that we will teach our daughters how to cook a meal, and we won't teach them how to feast at the Lord's table? You see, we're talking about growing up. We're talking about having to get our focus off the things of men and onto the things of God. See, when we're focused on the things of men, it's because we're just being children. It's time to put away our childish things. It's time to put away our childish behavior. It's time for us to be focused on the right things. Last thing, number four, fourth thing. I can hear the call to discipleship and still have my priorities wrong. This is another biggie. Listen to what he says. "And when Jesus called the people to himself with his disciples, he said to them, 'Whoever desires to come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross and follow me.'" Great call. "Whoever desires to save his life will lose it. Whoever loses his life for my sake and the gospel's will save it. What does it profit a man if he gains the whole world and loses his soul? What will a man give in exchange for his soul?" Jesus clearly called, and then he warned about priorities. He said, "Here's the call. Deny yourself, take up your cross, follow me." Here are the priorities, not the physical realm. The priorities of our life as followers of Christ is to be spiritual things, not creature comforts, not the things of this world, but the things of God. See, that's where the focus of our life, the priorities of our life. You want to know where somebody is spiritually, what level they're at, whether they're a babe, whether they're a child, whether they're a young adult. You ask yourself, where am I spending my time, my energy, my effort, my resources? What am I investing in? How do I take what God has given me and use it for His glory? That's the sign between being a child and an adult. What do we do with our stuff? What kind of stuff do we have? You know, some of us would never dream about putting $1,000 in the offering plate on a Sunday morning, and would never bat an eye of spending $1,000 on a new television set, 52-inch flat panel. I'm getting awfully quiet out there. Hello. Let me tell you, it's time to put away our toys. You say, "Well, I don't know." Let me tell you something. You know what the problem with our nation is? The guys in Washington, D.C., on both sides of the aisles, they're childish. Well, I got more response out of that than anything I've said today. Go figure. That's because I'm picking on somebody besides you, I know. No, the reality, though, is that they don't get along because they're kids. They're saying, "It's my ball." Let me tell you, It used to be the money in my pocket and your pocket. That's what they're fighting over. They're being like a bunch of kids. But we can't judge them without first judging ourselves. And we in the church today have grown comfortable being like a bunch of kids. We have our worship wars. I like that song. We have our preferences about this and that and the other thing. It's all about me. The truth about being a spiritual child, you can have insight and still be a spiritual child. You can hear the message clearly and still think you know a better way. You can be among His followers and still have your focus on the things of men. You can hear the call to discipleship and still have your priorities wrong. The question becomes, how do I move from where I am to where I need to be? How do I go from being a baby to being a, or from being a child to being an adult? Now, let me tell you something. Admitting that we're wrong is not giving up. It's growing up. And in the church, we have been wrong. Because we've assumed that if we get people saved and baptized, that they will automatically mature in their faith. And that's just not the case. It becomes awfully easy to be a child in the church for a long time. I thought, how do I illustrate that? I said, well, I'll take a toy box up there with me, and I'll get down on the platform, and I'll get my jacks out. And then I realized half the congregation won't know what jacks are. And I'd get a yo-yo out, but, I'd do that and hit myself in the head so many times that I'd have to finish this thing. Somebody else would have to come up and finish the sermon. And so this is what I came up with. The best illustration of what it means to be childlike in the church is this. Watch carefully. I don't want you to miss it. This is a really good sign. Some of you out there going, how long is he going to sit there? See, that's the question I'm asking you. How long are you going to sit there? See, that's the question. Because see, what happens to us is we come to know Jesus Christ, we accept Him as our personal Savior and Lord, we're born again, we become a baby. And we sit under just enough preaching and teaching that we move from being a baby to being a child. And then we find ourselves very comfortable just sitting there. It's time to put up our toys. And it's time to go to work. See, there is an answer, and the answer is the same no matter what stage we're talking about. It requires an intimate connection with Christ, a deep commitment to His Word, and it talks about letting Him transform our lives. Whether we go from being a baby to being a child to being a young adult to becoming a parent. It requires the same thing. So let's go to Roman numeral 2 in your outline. Moving from childhood to adulthood. Listen to what it says. Listen to what Jesus said. These are important words. For whoever is ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of him the Son of Man will also be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father with the holy angels. And he said to them, assuredly I say to you, there are some standing here, there are some in this place who will not taste death until they see the kingdom of God present with power. That's what I want. I want before I die to see the kingdom of God present in my life, in my church, in my community, not just present, but with power. I want to see that. And the way that will happen is for me to stop being ashamed of my Savior. I've got to stop being ashamed of Him. It requires a connection to Christ. Number one, it requires a connection with Christ. For whoever is ashamed of me, I can no longer be ashamed of Jesus Christ. I cannot apologize for preaching Him as the only way of salvation. We live in a world that says there are many paths to God. I have to be one who says there is one way to God, and that's through the shed blood of Jesus Christ. You see, the reality is there is a way for me to go from being a child to being an adult, but what that requires is that I get rid of the shame that I have for my Savior Jesus. I've got to quit compartmentalizing my life. It's got to be a 7-day-a-week, 24-hour-a-day lifestyle. Let me tell you something. God doesn't just want your time on Sunday. He wants your life on Monday. See, we live in a society that says, you can be religious, but let's keep that on Sunday. Keep it in the four walls of the church. And Monday belongs to the workplace. You got to go to work Monday and Tuesday. And when Saturday rolls around, though, that's your free time. You can do anything you want to do on Saturday. Just go back to church on Sunday. And I'm telling you, when we live that way, we are denying Christ in this generation. I love what he said. He said, among this adulterous and sinful generation. Here's my question. Am I different than my generation because of my connection to Him? Am I different than my generation? It requires a connection to Christ. Second thing, it requires a commitment to His commands. For whoever is ashamed of me and of my words, I cannot hide from this any longer. I can't compromise it. If Scripture says it, then I need to believe it. It may be politically incorrect. But notice the alternative. He says, if I'm ashamed of Him and of His Word, then when He stands before the Father, He will have to be of me. No, the sign that I'm moving from being a child to being an adult is that I surrender my life to Him and to His Word. Here's the sign of being a child. I get some of it. Here's the sign of being an adult. I live some of it. Do you get the difference? I understand some of it, child. I'm applying it and living it, adult. I've got to live it. I've got to study it. I've got to hear it. I've got to open it and get in it myself. I read something just the other day that said, if you want to keep your kids' feet on the ground, put responsibility on their shoulders. I like that. Let's put it in the spiritual realm. You want to keep your spiritual feet on the rock? Take responsibility for your spiritual growth. You want to be firmly planted on the rock that is Jesus Christ? Then take some responsibility for your own spiritual growth. Don't be ashamed of Him. Don't be ashamed of His Word. Open it up. Study it on your own. Apply it to your life and live it. Live it. Last one. Last thing. It requires a change in my conduct. Notice what it says. For whoever's ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation. What he's saying there is that my lifestyle should be different than the generation that surrounds me. Here's the problem. The problem we face in the church today is that too much of the world has come in here. It's easier to find the work of the flesh than the fruit of the Spirit in the church. We get rid of our big bad sins and we hang on to our little bitty ones. And the reality is, we're not much different than the world out there. And we should be. We should be. We should be very different. We should be set apart. If I'm going from being a child to an adult, my lifestyle should change. Don't you know that in the physical realm, there are things that children can do, things that children can get away with, things that children can participate in that adults can't, and vice versa. There are things that a child can't do in our society today, but an adult can. Let me tell you, when it comes to the spiritual realm, there are things that await those who will become adults, that will grow up in Christ, that a child will never experience. This is how Jesus put it. He said, there are some of you that are in this very room that will not taste death until you have seen the kingdom of God come with power. Man, what would we do if the kingdom of God suddenly came with power in this place? You think the world out there has talked about us up to this point? What if we just committed ourselves to grow from where we are to where God wants us to be? What if we just committed ourselves to get into His Word, to be submitted to Him? What if we just committed ourselves to be followers of Christ, to actually hear His call, to take up our cross, deny ourselves, and follow Him? What if we just did that day by day by day, moment by moment? What a difference. I believe we would see the kingdom. I believe we'd see the kingdom come in power in this place and make a difference in people's lives. How do you do it? I just told you. Three steps. Notice, these are the same three steps we talk about every time. We must accept Jesus Christ. That requires a connection to Christ. We must commit ourselves to follow Him. It requires a commitment to His commands. And we got to trust Him to change us, to change our conduct from who we are, our attitudes, our actions, to what they need to be. I'm ready to be more committed than ever before. I'm ready to see His kingdom in my life with power. I'm ready to put away my toys, to put up my childish things. I'm ready to go deeper in my walk with Him than ever before. How about you? Would you bow with me? Thank you, Father, for the truth of your word. I pray, Lord God, that it's touched people's hearts. Father, Jesus spoke, and the Bible says that He spoke openly, that it wasn't hidden. And I pray, God, that the message today, I've tried to proclaim it openly. There's no secret to it. It's simply been laid out in simplicity. Father, my prayer is that this has been a challenge to those of us who claim to be followers of Christ. That maybe we need to look at our lives and redefine our priorities and put our priorities more in line with your way and your things. Help us to focus our attention not on the things of men and the things of this world, but on the things of God. Father, my prayer for Christians that are part of this church is that we've been challenged to go to that next level. That we've been challenged to develop a hunger for your word and to not be ashamed of Christ, but to be bold in our witness and bold in standing on His word day by day by day.